Morning. Welcome to our service of worship this morning. Welcome also to those who are joining us online or through our tablet ministry. A few announcements. First off, this beautiful plant that's up here, I'll move it out of the way so people can see it, was donated by the by May's family. It's from the funeral. So they wanted to give back to the church, knowing that the church meant so much to her. So we thank the family for that. And on that note, Norm also has her granddaughter Michelle's address or her son Gordon's address if you'd like to get it from her. A few other notice of the annual meeting. It's going to be taking place Sunday, February 21st after our worship service. So we'll just stay in the sanctuary after worship and we'll go through the business of the church. And we can use the screens and everything with that. Annual meeting reports. Today is the day. So if you haven't got your reports in, please do so. If not today, in the next day or two, as I know Betty needs time to get it all together and she needs all the reports before she can do that. So please get those in as soon as possible. Also, just a reminder of the games night tonight for the Kensington Area Youth Group, meeting at the Southwest River United Church at 6:30. And we're doing a Thinking of You, Prince County Hospital. The Ladies Guild is kind of spearheading this. So the next 3 months, February, March, and April, we're going to be collecting items that are used for patients that are there, patients in need. And there's a suggested list of items at the front entrance there. There's one posted, and I think there's also some that are created that you can take home. Also, if you get the email, I've put it in that list in there. And just some of the lists of stuff there. There's things for adults, things for children, anything from personal care products to just activities that they can use while they're at the hospital itself. So you can bring those in the next 3 months. Also, just the last week to sign up for the Lenten book study. So if you'd like to take part and you want me to order a book for you, please let me know. And as I said too, this time we're going to be doing a video series along with it. So it's going to be a little bit different format than the last one. And if you'd like to just attend without reading, there's lots of discussion that goes on with that. And we can talk around the videos as well. So you don't need the book necessarily if you'd like to come. And the dates of those are, it's going to start Wednesday evenings, February 17th, and run through to March 24th, and Thursday mornings, February 18th, and running to the 25th. Let us begin our service of worship as we sing our introit. Join me in the responsive call to worship. God's praise endures forever. God's praise endures forever. God's praise endures forever. Let us worship our eternal God who calls us to this time and place. I'm going to sing our opening hymn, All the Way My Savior Leads Me. be seated. Let us join our voices together as we say our gathering prayer. Loving God, you are the wisdom behind all mystery. As we open our eyes and look around at your wondrous creation, we experience your glory that surrounds us. From the silence of the early morning to the brightness of the sun reflecting off the white snow, we witness the beauty of your world. Lord, we give thanks for the deep joy that comes from encountering you, whether in your creation or through those around us. Lord, we gather in worship to express our reverence and praise for all your blessings. Together we celebrate the good we have experienced, knowing that it all comes from your gracious and loving hand. And yet we are strangely resistant to your grace. There are so many times we turn from you, O God. Times when we forget that all the goodness we receive comes from you. We focus on what troubles us and ignore the help and healing you offer. We seek wisdom and meaning in the wrong places. We confess we can be cruel and harm others. Lord, forgive us and give us the courage to live our lives with your love. Together we pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. And give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever. Amen. Friends, hear the good news. Anyone who is in Christ is a new creation. The old life has gone away, a new life has begun. Thanks be to God that we can make a new start, forgiven and set free. Let's ask for understanding of God's holy scriptures. Source of wisdom, we ask that you still our minds in these moments of listening, so that we may be fully present, fully attuned to your life-giving word this day. Amen. Our responsive reading today comes from Psalm 111. Praise for God's wonderful works. Praise the Lord. I will give thanks to the Lord with my whole heart in the company of the upright in the congregation. Full of honor and majesty is his work, and his righteousness endures forever. He provides food for those who fear him. He is ever mindful of his covenant. The works of his hands are faithful and just. All his precepts are trustworthy. He sent redemption to his people. He has commanded his covenant forever. Holy and awesome is his name. Our scripture reading from the gospel today comes from Mark's gospel, chapter 1, verses 21 through to 28. And they went to Capernaum, and when the Sabbath came, he entered the synagogue and taught. They were astounded at his teaching, for he taught them as one having authority and not as the scribes. And just then there was in their synagogue a man with an unclean spirit, and he cried out, "What have you have to do with us, Jesus of Nazareth? Have you come to destroy us? I know who you are, the Holy One of God." But Jesus rebuked him, saying, "Be silent and come out of him." And the unclean spirit, convulsing him and crying with a loud voice, came out of him. And they were all amazed. And they kept on asking one another, "What is this? A new teaching with authority? He commands even the unclean spirits, and they obey him." At once, his fame began to spread throughout the surrounding region of Galilee. This is the word of the Lord. Excuse me. Whether it's their physical presence, their demeanor, the way they speak, or the position or the title they hold, some people just command authority. When we're young, adults, specifically our parents and grandparents, our aunts or uncles, are often those that we recognize as having authority. This also pertains to professions like teachers and principals, police or firefighters, doctors or nurses. Especially in the past, clergy and religious officials were deemed to have authority, particularly concerning faith and moral living. And then there's the military, where those above you in rank are literally your commanders and have the authority to instruct you to do what they want you to do. And the same might also be said of a boss or of a coach. When I first started teaching, I quickly learned the need to command authority. Whether I was teaching 4 or 5 year olds in kindergarten or 13 year olds in grade 8, to effectively teach, you need to assert and establish your authority. Now, I didn't walk into the classroom and run it like a boot camp. I didn't have to do my best impression of a drill sergeant getting in their faces, yelling or raising my voice, or staring them down, or threatening them within an inch of their lives if they stepped out of line. Although there were some classes I taught that I would have liked to have the students drop and give me 20 every time they got out of line. Instead, establishing authority as a teacher meant creating rules and expectations and being consistent. The key was having the respect and the ear of the students, because in doing so, life was easier and the day much calmer if the students knew who was in charge. And as I began this message saying, some people just radiate authority. Their mere presence commands respect and attention, while others, they need to work at it. And stereotypically, when I think of those who exude instant authority, I often imagine a big, stern-faced man with a no-nonsense look and demeanor. However, from my own experiences, I know people don't have to fit this mold. Growing up in my home church, there was a matriarch within the congregation who was the longtime clerk of session, as well as the chair of one of the church's ladies' groups. She was tall, she was well-dressed, she was punctual, she was efficient. Her demeanor commanded respect, and you couldn't help but listen to her. In short, she was a force to be reckoned with. She was also the self-appointed person in charge of the church's kitchen, and people learned very quickly that everything had its place, and if you were going to use the kitchen, you'd better make sure that everything was put back where it belonged, or you'd definitely hear about it. Her authority reigned, and she oversaw many aspects of the life of the church. And I'm not saying she steamrolled her own ideas or agenda, or that she did what she wanted to the detriment of the church or the congregation. She was simply one of those people that held power over many because of the way she conducted herself and the respect that she received. Now, I'll admit that as a young person in the church, her authority and command over me was primarily based on fear. No doubt because my early experiences and encounters with her weren't exactly positive. Once or twice, my friends and I were scolded for not behaving in church. When she caught us running around the church or playing where she didn't think was appropriate, we found ourselves looking up at her stern face as she gave us the what for. Perhaps she went over the top, but she was effective. And we listened because we recognized that there was something about her that commanded respect. And we were also scared. But as I got older, I came to know her in a more positive light and appreciate her faith and her commitment to the church. I respected her for her work and for her desires for maintaining reverence for the church building and those who attended. I recognized her authority as a leader in the church, no longer out of fear, but instead out of respect for her commitment and her faith. Similarly, in our Bible passage today, those who were present in the synagogue recognized Jesus' authority both through his teachings and his actions. And it appears that it didn't take them very long to realize that Jesus was special. Mark tells us that Jesus and his disciples traveled to Capernaum, and when the Sabbath came, he entered the synagogue and taught. This wasn't unusual. Guest readers and teachers were probably a common enough occurrence. However, in this case, we're told that those who were in attendance at the synagogue that day were more than impressed with Jesus and his teachings. In fact, Mark describes how they were astounded at his teaching, for he taught them as one having authority and not as the scribes. Mark doesn't tell us what scripture Jesus was reading or what his interpretation or his teachings from it were. But whatever he said got the attention of those in the congregation there that day. This isn't to judge or demean the scribes and what they taught. We shouldn't assume that what the scribes taught in the synagogue was wrong. Instead, there was just something special, recognizably different about what Jesus was saying. Maybe he had great anecdotes or real-life applications which he connected to the holy text that hadn't been thought of or mentioned before. Perhaps he drew parallels to other scriptural texts that were new for the listeners. We'll never know. All we do know is that Jesus' presence and teachings made people's ears perk up, and he commanded their attention. And amazingly, at least to me, is that the people recognized and accepted Jesus and his power and his authority before the man with the unclean spirit even walks through that synagogue door. This means that Jesus assumed his authority even before the climax of the story takes place. You think it'd be the other way around. If the man with the unclean spirit had come into the synagogue crying out and carrying on, and Jesus had rebuked the spirit before he'd started his teachings and his interpretation of the scripture, then we could understand why the audience would have reverence and awe for Jesus. The act of exorcism might have convinced the congregation that there was something special about Jesus and that they should take notice, that they should listen. You'd think this miracle would have been the deciding proof of his power. But instead, we discover that Jesus had already established that he was different and that he commanded authority. Mark clearly describes that from Jesus' reading and interpretation of the holy texts, the people were amazed and recognized his influence and his ability before Jesus even sees the man with the unclean spirit. Therefore, as awesome and as amazing as that exorcism or casting out of the evil spirit was, it wasn't the catalyst for the people to recognize Jesus' authority. Make no mistake, the act of casting out the unclean spirit made a difference. The miracle did confirm his authority and power to those who were present. As they listened to Jesus rebuke the spirit, and as they watched the man convulse on the floor, they were all amazed, and they kept on asking one another, "What is this? A new teaching with authority? He commands even the unclean spirits, and they obey him." So Jesus' exorcism in the middle of the synagogue served to confirm that he was something special, even if the crowd didn't recognize or totally understand what was going on. And not surprisingly, both his teachings and his miracle lit the rumor mills flame. As Mark tells us, at once his fame began to spread throughout the surrounding region of Galilee. No doubt about it, this was quite the beginning to Jesus' ministry. Modern-day public relations representatives couldn't have asked for a better start if they were trying to promote their new talent. Jesus had arrived on the scene, and with a bang, and arguably with success. Not only had he impressed and caught the attention of those listening to his teaching, but this miraculous casting out of the unclean spirit seemed to solidify his authority. And if you haven't noticed the theme, Jesus' authority is at the core of this story. It's on his divine authority that everything rests. This account of Jesus' first step into ministry both exemplifies and sums up who Jesus was and what he came to do. Upon entering the synagogue, Jesus shows his knowledge and understanding of the scriptures as he reads and interprets them for those who are listening. Plus, we have the added proof of his authority as he casts out that unclean spirit. In this text, we see Jesus act and heal with authority and with compassion. He physically shows God's love and grace. The people in the synagogue identified and they accepted Jesus' authority. They didn't fully understand what they were hearing or what they were seeing, but they still recognized that Jesus had a power and authority that stood out above others. Unfortunately for us, we don't have the same opportunity to go and see Jesus in a synagogue or a church. We can't sit down in our pew and listen to his teachings or have the privilege of being present as he healed someone before our eyes. However, in some ways, we're more fortunate because we have his life's teachings and his ministry recorded for us in the scriptures. Instead of one example, we have access to multiple accounts of his casting out of demons, of healing the sick, of even raising the dead, all of which show Christ's power and Christ's authority. Uniquely, we also know of Jesus' ultimate sacrifice and the miracle of his death and resurrection, which bears witness to Christ's authority over sin and death, forever freeing us. Therefore, we're more than qualified to testify to our Lord's power, our Lord's love, and grace. In Mark's account, people recognized Jesus' authority through his words and deeds. They saw Jesus in a different light, someone who was like no one else, so much so that they went out and they spread the news to others. And we too are called to do the same. We encounter Jesus through the scriptures, through worship, through Bible study and prayer, the experiences of others, and through witnessing his work in our world. And from these, we come to recognize Christ's power and Christ's authority, which is like no other. In response, we too should go out and proclaim who he is and what he's done. It's news that all the world needs to hear. Friends, let's declare our Savior's authority to everyone who will listen, so that others may be astounded by his teachings and by his acts. Amen. Let us pray. Lord, in your first act of ministry, you showed your authority as you read and you interpreted the Holy Scriptures, and as you cast out the unclean spirit. Through these acts, people came to recognize your power and your presence and share the news around the countryside. Savior, help us to recognize your authority in our lives and in this world. We also pray that through the power of the Holy Spirit, we might have the strength and the courage to tell others about you so that they too may recognize your authority. All this we ask in Jesus' name. Amen. Something to think about this coming week. What does recognizing Jesus' authority mean to me? Jesus' ministry was often filled with challenges and with choices. And likewise, we face challenges and choices as we follow our Savior in each and every new day. And the invitation to give an offering week by week can also be a challenge. Yet the gifts we choose to offer continue his ministry of healing and hope in this world. Therefore, let's take up the challenge. Let us give as God has blessed us. Let us pray. Lord Jesus, we bring to you our gifts, asking that you would bless them so that they may accomplish more than we can ask or imagine in your name. Bless us too so that our lives speak of our choices to follow you and our ministries offer the healing and hope that you've offered us. Amen. Let's join together in singing God of Grace and God of Glory. seated. Let us come before God as we pray for God's people in the world. Lord of heaven and earth, your energy fills the cosmos and enlivens every part of our being. Thank you for the simple pleasures of each day and for the strength to meet the challenges that arise. When it feels like we have come to the end of our own resources, we ask that you'd replenish us with the energy of your Spirit so that we know you are there for us and with us. Lord, in these strange times of isolation and distancing, we are grateful for prayer in its many forms and the intimate ways that we can find companion and communion with you. Whether it's in words or in silence, we ask that you'd hear us now as we pray for your people and for this world. Lord, teach us how to be more faithful stewards of your earth and to live more respectfully in your creation. We pray for our leaders that they will make the difficult decisions to balance the economy and jobs and the protection of the environment. We pray that we may seek new and cleaner technologies, that we'd move to be less wasteful, and to work to protect the earth's climate. Almighty, in this difficult time where so many are out of work or have had their jobs affected, we pray for the economy locally, nationally, and globally. We pray for all those whose decisions shape our financial circumstance. We pray for employers and business owners who are struggling to keep going, and for those who've lost their companies or they're at risk. We lift up to you those who cannot find work or who are struggling to get enough work to pay the bills. For those who have lost their jobs or struggle with their new circumstances. Lord, teach us how to care for our neighbors in these days of economic uncertainty. We pray for our own circle of family and friends. Gracious and loving God, heal, bless, lead, and encourage them. Grant each one of them the particular gifts needed this day and lead them to a healthy and productive future. We pray for our neighbors and strangers in our community who face struggles and sorrows as the pandemic stretches on. We thank you for the work of groups and organizations and individuals that seek to help all those in need. We thank you for the continued support of those who donate, who give up their time and talents, and who share their love and care for others in many different ways. Lord, remind us that we all belong to you and to each other. We pray that we continue to respond to one another with compassion and with kindness. Open our eyes to the needs and give us the courage and the resources to step up and to step out in faith. And God of healing and reconciliation, we pray for those who are hurting, physically, emotionally, and spiritually. We lift up to you those who are in hospital, those who are undergoing or awaiting treatments, those who are anxiously awaiting test results or a diagnosis. And we pray for those who suffer from chronic conditions. We ask for strength and healing for those with addictions and those who suffer from mental illness. We pray for your comfort and hope upon those who are grieving the loss of a loved one. Lord, may your presence be felt. And finally, in the silence, we bring to you the cares and the hopes that are on our minds today. Loving God, thank you for hearing our prayers as we hand them all over to you. In Jesus' most precious name we pray. Amen. Our closing hymn today, My Hope is Built on Nothing Less. friends, go in peace to love and serve the Lord and one another. Go with courage and faith, knowing that you are not alone. For you go with the grace of the Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the presence of the Holy Spirit, now and forevermore. Amen.